Good afternoon, everyone. Lisa and I want to thank you for coming to this celebration of our dad's life.
We're here to celebrate both his life and his legacy. He gave me the gift of music and humor, and he showed us all how to let the good times roll.
Okay. I want to say that, this will be a little personal here, that most of who I am, of what I am, I got from my dad. And I have to say, in that, I am extraordinarily blessed. And I want to say to my father that I wouldn't change a lick, not even a note. And Lisa and I want to thank everyone for coming again today. I think it's a beautiful day, and thank you again, guys.
Let's R&B the house.
Good afternoon. I just wanted to say that the Wexler family and the Thomas family are inextricably tied, and you know how. I just want you to, if you would, for a moment, this is kind of our moment of silence, be alone with your memories of Jerry, and as I sing, just remember him fondly and know that he is at peace.
Tired and weary, but I must toil on till the Lord comes to call me away, where the morning is bright. There'll be peace in the valley for me someday. There'll be peace in the valley for me, I pray. No more sorrow, no more sadness, no trouble will there be. There will be peace in the valley for me. There the flowers will be blooming, but the grass will be green, and the sky will be clear and serene. The sun ever shines, giving one endless beam, and no clouds there will ever be seen.
A familiar song. If you know the chorus, sing along. There will be peace.
no more trouble will there be. There will be peace in the valley for me. Yeah. Oh, oh.
When somebody asks me, how would you characterize the Atlantic Sound, I got this notion, I said, it's what you would call immaculate funk.
Song called Jailbird, and is dedicated to jailbirds. I went to jail for beating my baby, and the judge gave me 90 days. He said, boy, you must be crazy, and I want to fix you from beating that lady. I said, yeah. baseball bat. Can you ride?
On the other hand, I earned my grits by coming to work early in the morning and becoming the daily op man running a company from 11 o'clock on, and then recording at night. We would record 3-4 nights a week in those days, because we put out 3 singles every month, and we had a wonderful roster of repeating artists. I remember that the nut that we had to make, we had to sell 60,000 singles a month. 60,000, there were no LPs, to pay for the whole operation. That would be the rent, our salaries, session costs, advances to artists, and so on. But we had a fantastic roster in those days. People like, you know, Joe Turner, or the Drifters, the Coasters, courtesy of Lieber and Stoller, Laverne Baker, Ivory Joe Hunter, Ruth Brown, a great group called the Diamonds. We had from 1960 on, Solomon Burke, eventually, and Wilson Pickett. But even in the 50s, we had enough good artists to almost guarantee, of course, there are no ironclad guarantees, that we could make the nut every month. Armin Erdogan, I mean, he was my mentor. And we worked together until he was generous enough or kind enough to accord me some slight degree of parity with him. And so I started, you know, chipping in with my 2 cents worth.
You actually co-produced some stuff together.
Oh, we co-produced everything together from 1953 to 1959. Everything. We, and in fact, we shared an office together, and our desks were sort of, you know, diagonal to each other. And at 234 West 56th Street, that office became our studio. We'd move the desks against the wall and put one on top of the other. That's where I got my bad back. Tom Dowd would put out the few microphones that we used in those days, and boy genius that he was, we were able to record drums and bass before anybody else could, because Tom knew just where to put the mic.
Tom's already with you by that time.
Oh, no, Tom preceded me there. But as a freelancer, he would come to work as a freelance engineer, and then, but eventually he was hired on and became part of the staff. So I learned by being there, learning on the job, and Nam and I did everything together.
I just want to let everyone know that because of his late-night exertions last night, where he rocked the house at the Garden, Sam Moore was just feeling a little bit poorly today, and he sends his apologies, but his wife Joyce is going to come say a few words right now, so please welcome Joyce, okay?
He closed, and now I'm opening for him. Actually, he was on the stage stomping until about 1:30 in the morning, which I know there are several people here saw and knew, and he's a little hip this morning, and he couldn't quite swing it to get out of bed to be here on time, so he apologized. But, you know, Jerry was so significant in his life, as was Amit, as was Tom, Arif. I felt, and he felt, that we needed to say something from the Moors today, because it was that important. If it wasn't for Jerry Wexler, Sam probably would never have been signed to Atlantic. He would never have been exiled to Memphis, yes, where he wound up at Stax and made some of the most amazing hits, which still hold the test of time, as we saw last night, big time. He wouldn't have been brought back, made a solo album that unfortunately kind of had a few bumps in the road, and finally was released to critical, brilliant reviews. And he and Jerry, a few years ago, because of a documentary that Roger Friedman and the Pennybakers made, got him an opportunity to tell each other how much they loved each other, as he did have an opportunity with Amit around the same time. And Tom was in our lives all the time. And it was just the greatest thing and the most amazing thing for me as a witness to this history, to be able to see these guys and the love and the respect and the admiration that they shared for each other as artists, as friends, as men, as human beings. And so, Wexlers, thank you. Thank you so much. And I know that he really would be, he's really sorry he's not here today, but he really stomped and gave it his all last night on stuff that Jerry had an awful lot to do with. Thank you.
We have some other people that are going to speak on my father, but first I have a couple of letters I have to read, and the first one was from Jack Holzman, who had some business in England that he could not avoid. He was very regretful. This is from Jack. In 1970, I was in the midst of doing a deal that would add the Elektra E to Atlantic's A and the Warner's W, creating WEA, a coming together of talented people who love music and the business of music. As often happens in these situations, there comes a moment of doubt, a loss of certainty, a case of the jitters. I went to see Jerry and blurted it all out. Would I lose my autonomy? How was Steve Ross to work with? Jerry was quietly rabbinical for a moment, and then he said, Jack, you're too dear a friend for me to ever let you get into anything that wouldn't be good for you. That's all I needed to hear, and he was absolutely right. Warner Communications offered me opportunities to learn and grow, doing all kinds of things that would have never been put in my path except for Jerry's good counsel. It gave me a second career, which continues to this day. As a counselor and a friend, Jerry was a blessing, a mitzvah. And that's from Jack. Next, we're going to have Gary Giddens come up, America's foremost jazz expert and critic.
I was thinking when the montage of photographs were going by, there were a couple of Jerry and Dylan, and it struck me that there's a great similarity between what they did in the sense that both of them had this genius for absorbing everything in American music and then finding a different way to bring it out. I first became aware that Jerry knew who I was when the owner of the Village Voice told me he had had dinner with him, that he was a fan, and then I worked on a text of a photographic book by the wonderful photographer Carol Friedman, who's here, and she mentioned that my text was being edited by Jerry, which I thought was a little odd. And then he called me up once and invited me for dinner. And it was the most amazing thing, because all he wanted to talk about, and I mean a lot, was Adrian Rollini. It became this kind of thing. Now, Adrian Rollini was a bass saxophone player for the California Ramblers in the 1920s, and is the only musician I'm aware of in jazz or any other music who recorded on the hot fountain pen and the Goofus. And I didn't know very much about them at all, but he was fascinated by the entire group of white musicians who were in the Chicago area. Sometimes they were known as the Austin High Gang in the 1920s, and it occurred to me that he really sort of identified with them because they were the first guys, the first white guys up in the North who really crossed the divide and devoted themselves to trying to figure out black music and make it a part of their lives, and he knew their stuff unbelievably. And, you know, Jerry started out as a writer, but he managed to escape. He coined the phrase rhythm and blues. I think everybody knows that. And while we were talking, somehow Roy Eldridge came up. And Roy Eldridge is an idol of mine, and we'd become good friends. And Jerry loved him as well. And Roy Eldridge was the only artist that I ever knew that I really would like to have produced a recording of had I been a record producer. But I had this idea, and I'd run it by Roy, and he said, man, if you can get somebody to pay for that. So I laid it out for Jerry. I told him this whole idea, all the details, the musicians I would use. And he nodded. And then he said, have you ever seen a hot fountain pen? And I hadn't. I can now tell you that it's like a tiny clarinet with a saxophone mouthpiece and holes, but no key apparatus. So I tried to bring it back to Roy, and then he said, Gary, you're a writer. So that's where that went. I love the Joe Turner records he did, and I have to say something about the Boss of the Blues, because, you know, if I said something to him about the Aretha Franklin records, which are among the most brilliantly produced recordings ever made, they're just phenomenal, especially when you consider how she'd been recorded before. I mean, she'd done some great things before that, but just the whole concept that Jerry came up with was once in a lifetime. And of course, it made her career and it changed popular music. But he heard that from everybody. He didn't need to talk to me about Aretha Franklin. What he liked to talk to me about were the jazz guys, and I said to him that the Joe Turner record, you know, that's a masterpiece, there's nothing else like it. And he said, that's the best record I ever produced, which sort of floored me. And I remember I went to give a lecture in Europe, and when I got, my daughter had just introduced me to the iPod, and among the first things I put on it were the two Joe Turner albums that Jerry had done, and I played them the whole time I was there. And I called him up, and I thought, I'm not going to lead him into telling me it's the best record he ever produced. So I said, Jerry, what is the best record you ever produced? And he said, Joe Turner, Boss of the Blues. I thought, okay. But what really bonded us was when he found out I was doing a book on Bing Crosby. And man, we had dinner one night, and he started with, name any song by Bing, any song. And I would name one, and he would sing the first four bars. And I'd name a really obscure one, and he would do the next four bars. And this became a thing. He would call me sometimes, usually early, and he'd, you know, I'd pick up the phone, and it would be, I've got a pocket full of dreams, but with that serious Bronx accent. And he'd say, come on, name a song, name a song, name anything by Bing. And one time I said, hey, Jude. And he said, what are you talking about? And I said, Bing recorded, hey, Jude. And he just looked so disappointed. But, you know, he was a terrific guy. I think he would send me obscure CDs once in a while. I still have a stack of them on my desk. He was horrified that I didn't know the Dusty Springfield record, which he was extremely proud of, and sent that, of course. But I think that every time I had the good fortune to be in his company or talk to him, I always learned something. I have to just say that in the jazz world, Nesli Erdogan was always known as the good Erdogan. That's... And I said to him, are you aware of that? And he said, yeah, everybody's aware of that, but don't spread it around.
Our next speaker is a WBGO disc jockey, Bob Porter, who I would say knows as much about R&B and the blues from World War II to the mid-1960s as any man alive. So, Bob. Okay, pardon me, sir.
Yeah, he came in as a partner. He insisted on it. I don't think he really wanted to play poker with Jerry Wexler. He had come up through the hard scrabble end of the music business. He was a song plugger in the music publishing business, very successful at it. He was a Billboard reporter who did coin the phrase rhythm and blues, but he'd never produced a record. He always told everybody that Ahmet showed him the way, but Jerry contributed something else right away. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, the accompaniment on the Atlantic Records got better. It was Jerry who brought in Sam the Man Taylor. It was Jerry who brought in Mickey Guitar Baker, Lloyd Trotman to join Connie Kay and Harry Van Walls to make that remarkable Atlantic house band in the mid-50s. Together, they were a part of the nightly activity up at 256 West 56th Street. And they made the greatest rhythm and blues records of the time. Think of the storied names. Ruth Brown, Laverne Baker, Clyde McFadder, with and without the Drifters, the Clovers, Big Joe Turner, Ray Charles. Now, Jerry's partner was very much a night creature. Ahmet was rarely in the office, never in the office before noon. And you were just as likely to find him on 125th Street dealing with great blues or jazz artists as you would be finding him at 4 a.m. at El Morocco chatting up his society friends. A unique character nonetheless, but Jerry was the guy who had to mind the store, deal with the suppliers, pound on the distributors, sweet talk the DJs. Things continued more or less along the same lines when Nesli Erdogan joined the company in January of 1955. Nesli's job would be to build a jazz roster and establish an LP catalog. When taste began to change, Jerry would bring in arranger Ray Ellis and continue to develop more artists and create more hits. Atlantic did the first independent production deal with Lieber and Stoller. But the situation really couldn't last and didn't last. The company had grown to the point where Ahmet and Jerry could no longer afford to work together. When things would slow down, as they inevitably did, from time to time, Jerry was known to lament that the coasters were drifting and the drifters were coasting. The division of labor finally shook out to the fact that Nesli would be more involved with the international contacts while Ahmet would take the lead on the California pop and the English rock. Jerry stayed with what he knew best, rhythm and blues. And when Solomon Burke joined Atlantic in 1960, Jerry began to nurture the next generation of Atlantic producers. Burt Burns, Tom Dowd, Arif Mardin, King Curtis. He made a distribution deal with Stax. And of course, the music he produced or co-produced or executive produced or did deals for generated another group of storied names. Wilson Pickett, Joe Tex, Benny King, with and without the Drifters, Sam and Dave, Otis Redding, Aretha Franklin. The name Jerry Wexler may have been linked with others in shared credits, but there was never any question as to the identity of the lead dog. In later years, Jerry would often reflect on his term rhythm and blues, suggesting at one time that he should have named it blues and rhythm. On another occasion, he thought it should have been called rhythm and gospel. Now they were calling it soul music. But make no mistake, it was Jerry Wexler, more than any other single individual, who brought soul music to America.
Thank you, Bob. I got a request from Steve Cropper, and he was very unhappy that he couldn't be here, but he sent me a little letter, and I just want to read it because Cropper is so important in the history of Atlantic and important to my dad. Steve writes, "When I think of Jerry, I have to think of the time he brought Wilson Pickett to Memphis to record. Jerry and Jim went off to a meeting. Wilson and I stayed and started writing. The next morning, I picked them up, and we went into the studio to record the songs we'd written. We were so excited about In the Midnight Hour, we started working on it first. After running it down a few times, Jerry asked if I would play the backbeats on the guitar to match Al Jackson's snare beats. I thought I had a good guitar part, but I started playing the backbeats. All of a sudden, Jerry started dancing around, looking like he was shadow boxing and imitating the jerk dance. At the time, we all thought it was pretty funny. But two takes later, we had our first track, and we were all jumping up and down, dancing, and in the best mood the band had been in a long time. The two more hits were recorded, and Al and I kept using that delayed backbeat and created several more hits thanks to Jerry's suggestions. In the months and years to come, I learned so much from Jerry. His deep love and devotion to music should be an inspiration to everyone who enjoys the art of making music. He has been deeply missed and continues to be in our thoughts. Thank you, Jerry, for the inspiration you have given artists, producers, writers, musicians, and music fans from around the world. Sincerely, Steve Cropper." My father's two assistants from the Atlantic era, Jerry Greenberg and Mark Meyerson, are about to speak. Unfortunately, Jerry was feeling poorly, so he couldn't come, but he sent a video, and we're going to run that now, and then afterwards Mark's going to come up. So thank you, guys.
I first started talking with Jerry Wexler when I was a local promotion man in Hartford in the early 60s. Jerry called me and told me he just bought a great record that he was very excited about and sent me what they call a test pressing. Asked me to take it over to some radio stations and see what the reaction would be. Well, I did just that. The record started to explode. In 2 days, I called Jerry and told him he was going to have one of the biggest records he ever found. And sure enough, it was Percy Sledge, When a Man Loves a Woman. He would call me from time to time about asking me about different Atlantic records. He had the ability to really promote you and get you excited. In fact, even at one point, he sent his driver up to my house in New Haven, Connecticut, for me to hear a new Wilson Pickett record that he just recorded in Muscle Shoals. Jerry then asked me to join Atlantic Records in 1967 as his assistant. Working for Jerry, I tell everybody, was like joining the Marines. You either came out a sergeant or they found you in a swamp somewhere. He would call in the middle of the night asking questions. He really, really taught me how to become an all-around record man. In those days, Jerry was Atlantic Records. Atlantic was the house that Jerry built. He would do promotion. He would talk to sales distributors. He would find artists. Jerry was just unbelievable. He had such a sense of music, artists, and people. He was able to attract people to work for Atlantic Records, sales, promotion, marketing that were just unbelievable during those days. I remember Jerry signing such great artists along with Mark Morrison as Hall & Oates. Later, Jerry got with Shep Gordon and brought in Alice Cooper. Jerry's spectrum for music was so vast, it was incredible. Jerry loved being in the studio. That's kind of where I grew as taking over promotion activities and marketing activities, because he spent a lot of time in the studio. I think one of his favorite artists, obviously, was Aretha Franklin. I ran into Aretha not too long ago, and I said to her, "Boy, do we miss Jerry." I said, "I remember walking into the studio when Jerry, Arif, and Tommy were recording." That was the team. Arif Mardin, the creative musical genius, Tommy Dowd, the creative musical engineer, and Jerry, really the creative producer, finding songs, telling Aretha, "No, let's take another take. No, can you sing it this way?" They were quite the three musketeers of Atlantic. Jerry will really truly be missed, but I know his music will be with us forever and ever. All I could say is I owe him a lot of gratitude, and I have a lot of respect, because I never would have attained what I wanted to in the record business if it wasn't for Jerry Wexler. Thank you.
I met Jerry when I was a kid. My dad, Harry Meyerson, was an A&R man for MGM at the time, and he and Jerry were part of a circle of music business types who lived on Long Island, commuting to the city during the week and socializing with each other on the weekends. My earliest memory of Jerry was a New Year's Eve party my parents threw when I was about 13 years old. While the adults mingled, Jerry sat at the piano with me, explaining the nuances and differences between the 12-bar and the 16-bar blues for about an hour and a half, singing and playing along to give me examples. Growing up, I thought Atlantic was the coolest of all the labels and was in awe of our family friend who got to work with people like Ray Charles, Chuck Willis, and Big Joe Turner, just to name a few. So you can imagine how excited I was in 1969 when I got a call from Jerry asking me if I would be interested in becoming his assistant. 10 minutes later, I was in his office at 1841 Broadway, and for the next 6 years, I had the most exciting and enjoyable time of my professional life. Jerry's idea of the employer-employee relationship was strictly the Sicilian mode. He let me know early on that my primary loyalty was to him, then the company, and lastly to myself. His work ethic was that when you were awake, you were working, or mopping and bopping, as he put it. When he was producing a record, he solicited everybody's opinion, everyone from his driver to Ahmet Erdogan. "What do you think of that take? Do you like this rhythm track? Do we need more horns here? Which vocal do you like better?" In the end, he had the last word, which is a good thing, because his inordinate good taste and artistic instincts always were the best. It didn't matter where Jerry was physically, because every day for him was Atlantic Records Day. He never took a vacation that I'm aware of. And it was no surprise for me if he'd call on a Friday from Miami to tell me he was going to go fishing that weekend, searching for bonefish in Bimini, when on Sunday morning I'd get a phone call early in the morning asking me if the new, oh, ship to shore phone call, excuse me, asking if the new Led Zeppelin test pressing had come in. If he said he was taking some time in Europe, it meant he was going to the Montreux Festival to see some Atlantic act that was playing there. Working with Jerry was occasionally frustrating, frequently educational, and always exciting. He taught me many lessons, but the one lesson that stayed with me the most was his definition of what it takes to be successful. In his words, it was passionate attention to details. That's a lesson that applies not just to the music business, but to all aspects of life. And it was Jerry's passionate attention to detail that made the records he produced artistic and creative smashes. Ironically, in the early 70s, Atlantic Records became the number one record company in the world because of its rock acts, many of whom had been attracted to the label by the history and by the hits that Jerry had produced. It was Jerry's soulful world that I loved, and when I realized that the music he championed and also loved was becoming marginalized at Atlantic, I felt it was time for me to move on. I left the company in 1974, and Jerry followed a few years later. That was not, however, the end of our relationship, as we continued to see each other socially from time to time and had one last business deal. In 1978, I was living in Los Angeles, where I headed ABC Records' A&R department. Jerry phoned one day to tell me about his latest project. He was working on scoring a motion picture set in pre-World War I New Orleans called Pretty Baby. He asked if I thought ABC Records would be interested in releasing the soundtrack and sent me a cassette. I took one listen and was on the next plane to New York to make the deal. I met Jerry for lunch at Barney Greengrass, the Sturgeon King on the Upper West Side, where we were joined by the director of the film, Pretty Baby, Louis Malle. We had a great lunch talking about music and movies, noshing on smoked fish. And when it was all over, I felt a little sad that lunch was ending. It was better than cool to meet a great French filmmaker, but Jerry always introduced me to interesting people. The reason I was sad was that I realized then how much I missed being a regular part of Jerry's world, a world that was always filled with intelligence, humor, and passion.
Our next speaker is a noted writer, a biographer, and a great lyricist, and someone who manages to effectively channel a range of people, ranging from like Ray Charles to Cornel West. It's the writer David Ritz.
Well, my heart is really sort of coming out of my chest here. I want to testify and thank Lisa and Paul for giving me the chance to express my love for Jerry. We met about 35 years ago. I was working on Ray Charles's autobiography in L.A., and Ray told me, call Ahmed and Nesui and Jerry, because I can't recall anything. And I called Ahmed a whole lot of times, never called me back, called Nesui a lot of times, never called me back, called Jerry. He answers on the very first ring. And his question is, do you have an advance? And I tell him, yeah, and he says, is it enough to live on? And I said, well, I'm not sure. And he says, if you need any help, just let me know, and I'll be out in L.A. Next week, and we'll spend a couple of days together. And I think, a couple of days? And the next thing I know, I'm in the car, and I'm going over to one of those bungalows at the Beverly Hills Hotel where the music moguls play. And he is ripping and riffing and joking and smoking, and I'm as high as I can be on this joint called Jerry Wexler, and he's brilliant and a ferocious wit and a super funky storyteller, and I'm in heaven. And we become really good pals, and every time I do a book, he encourages me and gives me a blurb. And now it's the 80s, and I got a problem, because Marvin Gaye and I have written sexual healing together, and Marvin won't give me no bread. And I call Rabbi Wexler, and I say, you know, I love Marvin. He's the Michelangelo of R&B. He's my pal. He's my mentor. He's my idol. What should I do? And without hesitancy, Jerry screams across the country, sue the motherfucker. Next thing I know, my kids get to go to college, and it's the 90s, and Jerry calls me to do his autobiography. And I tell him, Jerry, I'm not sure I can do that book, man, because we're very close pals, and you do an autobiography with a guy, and there's all sorts of shit that can come up, and there's, you know, the bread, how are we going to divide the advance? And he tells me, I'll give you the whole advance. And I tell him, well, then I will do the book. And I was so proud of Jerry in doing that book, because every time we got into kind of a difficult area, like Shirley, who was Jerry's first wife, the one he calls his real wife, and the wonderful mother of Anita and Lisa and Jerry, Jerry would just tell me, go talk to her whenever her point of view is, just put it in the book. And when we start talking about Lieber and Stoller, with whom Jerry had kind of a falling out, Jerry would tell me, just talk to Mike and Jerry, whatever they tell you, just put in the book. So to me, one of the sort of high marks of integrity was Jerry's ability to have counter voices to his own in his own autobiography. Now, in the very last year of Jerry's life, my dear friend Harry Weinger and I went down to Sarasota to visit him, and he was still full of piss and vinegar. He was still the lion in winter, kind of roaring these great stories, and we just had a really beautiful time. But then the deterioration came pretty quickly, and I was here in New York working with Paul Schaefer on his book, and I was encouraging people to call Jerry, because at the end, Jerry's telephone calls were what were really keeping him alive. And I said to Paul, you know, you and Jerry really of each other, and give him a call, because this, you know, could be it. And Paul called him, and Jerry put him on the speakerphone, and Paul was having a hard time hearing him. And Paul said to Jerry, what line do you have me on? And Jerry said, Paul, I'm on the going down slow line. And when Paul told me that story, I thought to myself, Jerry Wexler, hip to the motherfucking end. And he was. He was sweet and sour. He was street. He was scholarly. He was a loyal, loyal friend. He was a lover of life. But mainly he was music. Rootsy, righteous music of the soul, whose divine spirit has us shouting out today, we love you, Jerry Wexler. We love you. Good God Almighty, we just love you. Thank you.
I want to thank Renee Pappas and Ken Lipper, because we have a proclamation from the mayor of New York City, Mayor Bloomberg, that Jimmy Douglas is going to come up now and read. Jimmy Douglas is one of the only engineer I can think of who was a major engineer back in the day, working with bands like the Rolling Stone and Foreigner, and then figured out how to make modern urban records and work with Timbaland, Missy Elliott, and a whole scat of talent that, you know, Very few people, if any, besides Jimmy, made that transition. So here's Jimmy Douglas.
This is a letter from Michael Bloomberg, his honor. It says, "Dear friends, it is a great pleasure to welcome all those attending today's memorial concert to remember and celebrate the life of a great New Yorker and legendary record producer, Jerry Wexler. Born in the Bronx to two Jewish immigrants, Mr. Wexler went on to become one of the most influential record executives of our time. From his work as a journalist at Billboard magazine, where he coined the term rhythm and blues, to his tenure as a partner at Atlantic Records, where he helped to produce some of the most iconic songs of his generation, Mr. Wexler not only made a significant impact in the music industry, but also shaped the cultural landscape of the 20th century. With an uncanny ability to develop that talent, Mr. Wexler helped to nurture the gifts of a number of greats, including Aretha Franklin, Ray Charles, the Allman Brothers, Bob Dylan, and many more. Throughout his illustrious career, Mr. Wexler made invaluable contributions to the cultural life of our city and far beyond. And although his job eventually took him to the South, he remained a quintessential New Yorker, never losing the energy, determination, and drive that characterize our great city. I am proud to join everyone gathered in commemorating and honoring his life. On behalf of the residents of New York, please accept my best wishes for a meaningful event in tribute to a true innovator. Sincerely, Michael R. Bloomberg." I'd like to take a minute to do my own little tribute to Jerry. I wish I had some of the funny stories you guys had. I was a teenager back in the 60s, or like towards the 70s, and being a teenager in the peace, love, and whatever era, I wasn't really there all the time, if you know what I mean. So I was there, and there was Jerry, and I had the good fortune to know him and his family, and he let me come to the studio at Atlantic Records. I came there at a time when Atlantic was about to go ballistic. They were going ballistic. It was in the heyday, the renaissance of Stax, the rock and roll revolution, 69, everything was just totally off the hook. And eventually, what would happen was I'd find these bands that I'd want to produce. And I'd say, "Jerry, you know, they're really hot. Can I do these?" And he'd go, "Yeah." I go, "Okay, great. So who's going to engineer it for me? Tom Dowd, you know, who's going to do this for me?" He goes, "You want it? You want to use the studio? You do it." And I'd do it, and I'd bring him the bands, and I'd go, "Jerry, what do you think of this band?" And he goes, "Sounds really good, Jimmy." He says, "Sounds really good." Oh, positive from Jerry. That's a great thing, as all you may know. He doesn't give it up that often when he does, but he does. Anyway, fast forward to eventually one day he would come through, and they were in a pinch and they needed something to mix real quick, and it was an Aretha record. He's like, "Here, just go mix it. No big speech, no anything." He just was like, "Here, you're in the ring, do it." And you know, and then the guy got the nod, which was a great thing. And then I wanted to produce a bunch of things for Atlantic, and none of them were, I would say, were big, big hits, but there was one record I did in 71 called Creation, which he let me produce. And this was between me and him. And the record sounded fantastic. It sounded amazing. It must have sold 3 copies, but it sounded amazing. And Jerry took me in his office and he said, you're a producer. You're a staff producer." Now, this conversation was between me and Jerry, so the money never changed and nothing else happened, but I just wanted to thank Jerry for helping me to start a career that probably never would have started without him.
Everything was terrific, I think, so far, but in a way I wanted to save the best for last. Zelma Redding, Otis's widow, got in touch with us, and she reached out and she sent a little something she wanted me to read today. So here we go. "Dear Lisa and Paul, I wish I could be there with you to celebrate your father's life and legacy. Jerry was a true pioneer in the field of rhythm and blues and soul music. He impacted the lives and careers of many major recording artists and left an indelible mark on American popular culture. On a more personal note, my family and I are forever indebted to Jerry for the wise counsel and guidance that he gave to my late husband, Otis Redding. I recall Jerry saying, "There is nothing I would not do for Otis." And I'm certain the same was true in reverse. It would be fair to say that they were a mutual admiration society. Otis held Jerry in the highest esteem as a music business executive, record producer, and most important, as a mentor and friend. Please accept my regrets for my absence. Extend my kindest regards and best wishes to your family and everyone gathered there to celebrate Jerry's life. Sincerely, yours, Zelma Redding. We're going to begin again with the musical portion of our program. And our first artist is the great Alan Toussaint, who we saw a little bit before backing Mac Rabernack. But he's not styling the same way with the hat and coat, but he's still got it way together. And here we go with Alan Toussaint. I also want to mention the band. I want to thank everyone who's helping here today. Our musical director, John Tiven, Jerry Jamad on bass, Anton Figg on drums, the Uptown Horns, Spooner Oldham, not right now, but in a little bit, Mike Finnegan, and what are the names of the band? John.
Domino Kirk,
Tabitha Fair, and Ellis Hooks on the background vocals. And I heard him in rehearsal last night. You guys are going to be pleasantly surprised. So here we go.
Just ain't bad as they seem. With you in mind, well, I can build my wildest dream. With you in mind, I can do anything. I know I can. With you in mind, honey, with you in mind. With you in mind, I went out looking for the best. With you in mind, 'cause you deserve nothing less. With you in mind, I've done so many things. Loving you brings. Oh, with you in mind, honey, with you in mind. Just like the flower drinking from the falling rain, the same rain that could wash it away. Instead, it gives it strength and gives it water. And before you know, another day with you in mind. I'll climb the mountain to the top. With you in mind, I know love's fountain will not stop. With you in mind, I can do anything. I know I can. With you in mind, honey, with you in mind, Mr. Guitar. It's like day with you in mind. I went out looking for the best with you in mind, 'cause you deserve nothing less. With you in mind, I can do anything, I know I can. With you in mind, honey, with you in mind, with you in mind, honey, with you in mind. Thanks to Jerry Wexler. Thank you.
That was just crazy. So I guess all I could say is the apple and the acorn don't fall too far from the tree. And my sister Lisa is going to get up with her band Big Sister. The Big Sister has been together for over 20 years. These are ladies who are very dedicated to making great rock and roll, and it shows the influence that, you know, that Lisa grew up with. So here's Big Sister.
There's a little atheist's anthem for Jerry.
Talk down to me. Up and do the next one with us.
Baby, let me tell you that I'm lonely, baby.
Thank God I like my sister's band. That's all I have to say. Okay, next, the band's going to take the stage with Bernard Purdy on drums, Spooner and Mike Finnegan on the keys, John Tibben and the Uptown Horns, our vocalists, and I also want to mention that right now, William Bell's going to step up and do his thing.
Thank you. Jerry once told me that this particular song is one of his favorite songs, so this is to Jerry with love. And I was one of those guys at Stax that, being an artist, I was always hanging around the studio and asking questions. And he was always gracious enough to answer most of them. I was wanting to know, how do you mic the drum head? Why are you putting the pillow in the kick drum? And I was actually just like a sponge, just soaking everything up. And he and Tom Dow taught me so much in the art of behind-the-scenes stuff that's going on in the studio and production. So this is just an honor to be here. Thank you so much.
When you
to my water, my well ran dry. I sit and wonder, said, how can this be? 'Cause I never thought you'd ever leave me. But now you've left me. Oh, how I cry. You don't miss your water. Till your well runs dry.
To mention that one of the Muscle Shoals rhythm section, Jimmy Johnson, is on the stage. Let's all give him a big hand, please. Now, I want to welcome to the stage again Lenny Kaye and Ronnie Blakely. They're gonna be accompanied by Barbara Cobb and Simon Kirk on the rhythm section. And they're doing a tune off of Dusty in Memphis. So let's give them a big hand, please.
I want to say thank you to Jerry for getting us all together. Thank you to Jerry for his vocabulary, his knowledge, which he so generously shared, his honesty, and for helping me personally in the things about life and death. Now you know me. You know how proud I am.
So love you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a warm welcome for Mr. Joe South.
One another's mind, yeah. Say how proud I am to be here today. Like all of us, I love Jerry Wexler very much. I met him back in about 1967, and of course in Muscle Shoals. And he meant so much to my life and to my career, and cut a lot of my songs. And he really liked this song here. It's a song I wrote with Troy Seals. It's called "We Had It All." Remember how I used to touch your hair.
that was always there. You were the best thing in my life, I recall. You and me, Lord knows, we had it all. I know that we could never live those times again. So I let these dreams take me back to where we've been. Stay there with you just as long as I can. Oh, it was so good. Yes, it was so good. Ooh, it was so good when I was your man. I'll never stop believing in your smile. Even though you didn't stay, it was all worthwhile. You were the best thing in my life, I recall. You and me, Lord knows, we had it all. Yes, you and me, Lord knows, we had it all. Thank y'all so much. What a great band. What an honor to play with these guys. Thank you, guys.
Louie-Ann Barton, ladies and gentlemen, please.
This is the song that Jerry heard me sing at a nightclub and came backstage and said, I want to produce a record on you. And then when we made the record, this turned out being our favorite cut. And it's very sentimental and special because of that. So this is to you, Jerry. Love you.
It's raining so hard, looks like it's gonna rain all night. And this is the time I'd love to be holding you tight, but I guess I'll have to accept the fact that you're not here. I wish the rain would hurry up and end, my dear. It's raining so hard, it's really coming down. Sitting by my window, watching the rain fall to the ground. This is the time I'd love to be holding you tight, but I guess I'll just go crazy
Next artist up is the great Betty LeVette, and I want to request that Mr. Pretty Purdy come up to the stage.
Does it make any difference? Which one? Does it make any difference? Which one?
Whichever one you like.
Okay. I have the unique distinction of being able to say that Jerry Wexler is the only person in this industry who's ever helped me until 5 years ago. He signed me to Atlantic Records in 1962 when I was 16 years old. I remember people asking me all the time in interviews, "You're from Detroit, why weren't you on Motown?" I said, "In 1962, Berry Gordy wanted to be on Atlantic." It was very true. Jerry gave me his home telephone number and told me if I needed anything to call him. Do you know what it was to have the home telephone number of a record executive in Detroit? And of course, being there in Detroit and him being in New York, I only called when I was with my friends. So I could call and make this collect call. He always accepted the charges and always sent me the $50 or $25 that I was asking for. In 1963, after I was grown, I moved to New York City, and I went to Atlantic, and I walked into his office. He saw me right away. I said, "Jerry, I want a release for my contract." I had never met him before. I'd only talked to him on the phone. And he was like, well, why? "Because my friends told me I should have had another record by now." He said, "Well, what are you going to do?" "I'm going to live in New York and get another record contract." He went into his pocket, took out his personal checkbook, and wrote me a check for $500. He said, "You're going to need this." And darned if I didn't. There were so many days when I still wish I had some part of that $500. I never had the opportunity to work with people who really were my friends. These people here, I finally got a chance to work with the Muscle Shoals people in 1972 on my first album, which came out 4 years ago. So when I looked at those pictures up there, it reminded me of a song, the only song I've ever written that was on my album that was released 2 years ago. The line said, "All those faces on the pictures up there just makes me remember when my table was bare, living at my mama's house, taking food from my family's mouth." But then the money came. I'm honored to be here and so very, very glad that he told me the things that he told me that helped me hold on while I waited for this darn near 50 years. I'm very, very glad though now to be a part of you. Thank you for having me.
Brings a tear to my eyes when I began to realize, Lord, I've cried so much. Yeah. Gone.
my tears are running wild. Daddy, if you don't think, you're coming back home soon, I believe I'm gonna drown in my own tears. Now I know it's true. That into each life, some kind of rain, some kind of rain is gonna pour. I'm so blue sitting here without you. It keeps on raining. It keeps on
to welcome Steve Bassett to the stage, and I want to mention that we're going to do some a song that Big Joe Turner made famous that my dad produced, and just a lot of what we think of rock and roll actually really happened between 1950 and 1955, and the influence of this song on rock and roll is almost immeasurable. And I also want to thank both Jan Wenner of Rolling Stone magazine, Atlantic Records, Craig Kalman, for the generous support they gave my sister and I when we were trying to mount this memorial for our dad. Thank you, guys. We really appreciate it.
I was introduced to Jerry Wexler in 1980. I'd been signed to Columbia Records. And John Hammond Sr. set up a meeting between us. And, of course, I knew everything that Jerry had done and had heard some stories about him. And I knew that he had certain ways of doing things. And came to New York City and went to lunch with him. He said, "Well, Steve, if you were going to produce this record, how would you do it?" I said, "Well, you know, a little shy. If I get my own opinion in, I said, I'd go to Muscle Shoals and do it with the Swampers." He said, "Let's do that." One, two.
in town. And now you wear long dresses and the sun comes shining through. Can't believe my eyes, all that mess belongs to you. I believe to my soul.
Thank everyone again for coming, and I just want everyone to try to keep in their hearts, you know, my dad and who he was and how he was with everybody, because the most rewarding part of this whole thing for Lisa and I are the number of people that we reached out to that came back with us. With we're on the road, we just ain't got the grits to get here, we're sick, we can't make it. But the number of people that told me that they love my dad, that he changed their lives, that he touched them deeply, I lost count after a while. And for me, this, Lisa and I, this was the best part of it. So Lisa and I both, we both want to thank you. We both want to thank everybody for coming.
I called David Ritz up and said, I think we should try this again. And he said, just put it out there and it'll happen. So I picked it up and I brought it to Paul and he carried it all the way till now.
Not true. We did it together.
Oh, no, we didn't.
Thanks again, everybody. Have a good day.